مرة عصف الأنين بداخلي، كم مرة قد ذاق قلبي من أسى رحلة تمر، وكم كرهت مصابها لكن رأيت الخير يسكب في أنا، كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين ما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is part 2 of my Salahuddin Ayubi series, Rahmatullah Ali. And part 1 just gave you an introduction to this great man and his upbringing, his personal achievements, his conduct, his manners, his bravery, etc. So you could sort of understand how this man cared for the Ummah at large. He wasn't just a warrior or a military genius or a military commander. He was the complete package, rahmatullah alayh. Now coincidentally, subhanallah al-azim, after recording part one, I didn't plan for this video to be done in terms of the actual events. Subhanallah, it wasn't even intended. I didn't plan it in this way. But when Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi started taking back territories and recapturing the Muslim lands, a famous battle was the decider or sort of led to the recapture of Baytul Maqdis. And this battle is called the Battle of Hittin. Now, funny enough, the Battle of Hittin happened in this month. Subhanallah, I didn't even plan it. The Battle of Hittin happened, and as you can see on screen, the Battle of Hittin happened on July the 4th, 1187. And it happened in northern Palestine. And that marked the defeat and annihilation of the Christian Crusader armies of Ghidi Lusion, King of Jerusalem, by the Muslim forces of Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayh. It paved the way for the Muslim reconquest of the city of Jerusalem in October 1187 and of the greater part of the three Crusader states, the city of the county of Tripoli, the principality of Antioch, and the kingdom of Jerusalem. Just 10 days ago, or just under 10 days ago, the Battle of Hattin, the deciding battle, happened. And I didn't even plan it this way, subhanAllah. And in the near future, I will be discussing the Battle of Ain Jalut, led by Saifuddin Qutuz and Zahir Baybars, which sort of halted the Maghul. I'm going to discuss that later. But what you will notice is where the battlefield of that battle was and the battlefield where Hattin happened. I'm going to show you the photo of Hattin. So close together. So close together. And I've been to Palestine, tabarakAllah, 3 times. And I've always wanted to go to northern Palestine to see the battlefields. So inshallah soon, I just didn't have the time. I've only been there for like 6-7 days, so I didn't have, you know, enough time to go and travel. But inshallah, in the near future, that will be the intention to go up the north and see the actual battlefields of Hattin and Ain Jalut, where Ain Jalut happened. As you can see on screen, this is the actual battlefield. This is Hattin, and this is in northern Palestine. Okay, so as you can see, this is Hattin, and the battleground of Ain Jalut, or the battlefield of Ain Jalut, isn't so far away from this particular place. So two significant battles of Islam that happened in Palestine happened so close together. Hattin, this is where the battlefield happened. So let's recount the story, okay? So the Ibn Shaddad mentions the chapter. It says, ذَكَرَ وَقَعَتْ حَطَّيْنَ الْمُبَارَكَةَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. It says the sort of account of the Battle of Hattin, which was a blessing for the believers. And he starts off, Ibn Shaddad says, وَكَانَتْ فِي يَوْمُ السَّبْتِ رَابِعُ وَعِشْرِينَ مِنْ رَبِيَ الْآخَرِ مِنْ شُحُورِ السَّنَةِ ثَلَاثَ وَثَمَانِينَ وَخَمْسَمِيَةِ. He says that this battle took place on a Saturday, okay, in رَبِيَ الْآخَرِ 583, which reaccounted for the 4th of July, which is this month. وَذَلِكَ أَنَّ السُّلْطَانْ رَاءَ النِّعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ بِإِسْتِقْرَارِ الْقَدَّمَهُ فِي الْمُلْكِ وَتَمْكِينَ اللَّهِ إِيَّاهُ فِي الْبَلَدِ. He says that the Sultan basically perceived that in his sort of blessings of Allah's favor towards him, which is his evidence of having control over the land and the people. And he mentions that the people strived and to fulfill the jihad, and he summoned all of his forces, etc. So I'm just trying to sort of make this very, very concise and not to sort of drag on, but this is very important as well, and this shows the sort of insightfulness of Salahuddin Ayubi. And he mentioned Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayh always used to go out on a Friday. Why was that? Okay, why was that? لا سيما أوقات الصلاة الجمعة. Okay, for, especially in the times of Friday prayer, to seek the blessings of the du'a of those خطباء على المنبر. And this is probably the most likely of why the du'as used to be answered at that time. So Salahuddin رحمه الله عليه used to go out on Fridays, and ideally during the times of Jum'ah, so that the Jum'ah prayers to pray in congregation, they make the du'a, they're going out, you know, for jihad, to protect the Muslims, to, you know, recapture the Muslim lands that were taken with aggression by the Crusaders. And, you know, it shows that he was always seeking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's assistance. And no better than a day of Jum'ah, and no better than a Salat of Jum'ah, so that all of them made du'a, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him victory in this particular time of distress, because it's a very, very difficult time, especially when, you know, you're going out in summer as well, July, you know, the heat, etc. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aids the believers. Tabarakallah. We'll carry on. So to summarize, he mentions that he moved and camped by the west of Tabriya on top of a mountain, okay? And was awaiting on the Afranja, meaning the Crusaders. And he was awaiting them, but the Crusaders didn't come. فَلَمْ يَتَحَرَّكُوا مِنْ مَنْزِلَتِهِمْ He did not move from their position. So what happened? He says, وَكَانَ نُزُولَهُ فِي هَذِهِ الْمَنْزِلَةِ يَوْمَ الْأَرْبَعَ هَذِي وَعِشْرِينَ مِنْ رَبِيعِ الْآخَرِ الْمَذْكُورِ He says that this basically took a position on the Wednesday, the 21st of Rabi' al-Akhir, and he says, فَلَمَّا رَاءَهُمْ لَا يَتَحَرِّكُونَ He says, when he saw that they weren't moving, he basically descended upon them, okay, and attacked them, okay? He attacked them, attacked their side at all. He says that after the Crusaders learned what happened in Tabriya, they could not have any patience, okay? And they basically went out to defend Tabriya. حتى كان الصباح السبت الذي بروك فيه فطلب كل من الفرقين مقامه. He says that on Saturday, okay, in the Saturday morning, which was a blessing, okay, which was a blessing, and it was requested from both of the parties of their meaning of their maqam, of their stations, and that both sides knew or sought their positions, and they realized that if any was broken, okay, and would be obviously moved off, and they will be basically done for. And look what it says here, subhanAllah al-Azim. وَتَحَقَّقَ الْمُسْلِمُونَ أَنَّ مَنْ وَرَائِهِمُ الْأُرْضُونَ It says that the Muslims knew and were aware that behind them was Urdun. And between them was what? Was the enemy, basically. So now Ibn Shaddad is going to explain what happened in the battle. Okay, Ibn Shaddad is now going to explain how the battle ensued. SubhanAllah al-Azim, the famous battle of Hittin, the very decisive battle of Hittin, as you can see on screen. And it says that the Muslim charged the wings, you know, the right and the left, and they charged the وَحَمَلَ الْقَلْبِ, and they charged the, meaning the center. And it mentions they all shouted out at once, meaning in one loud voice. And what did Ibn Shaddad say? فَأَلْقَ اللَّهُ الرُّعْبِ فِي قُلُوبِ الْكَافِرِينَ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala casted terror in the hearts of the disbelievers. And then he mentions that it was the right upon us that the victory was given to the believers. I think this is a Quranic ayat. It doesn't mention anything in the footnotes, but I'm sure this is a Quranic ayat. That the Muslims, the people of Islam, surrounded the people of disbelief. وَالْطُغِيَانِ مِنْ كُلِّ جَانِبِ وَأَطْلَقُوا عَلَيْهِمِ السِّحَامِ And basically the Muslims or the people of Islam surrounded the people of disbelief and impiety, okay, and shot arrows against them, and they fled, okay, and group fled, meaning the Crusaders, and they were pursued by the Muslim heroes, and not one of them survived that fled, okay, that one of them survived that fled, and another group took refuge, and where did they take refuge? يقال له الحطين. And they took refuge in a hill called Hittin. Okay, and he mentions that وهي قرية عنده وعندها قبر شعيب عليه الصلاة والسلام وعلى صار الأنبياء. Okay, and he mentions that this is the place where the grave of شعيب عليه السلام is, and the rest of the prophets, peace be blessings be upon them. And then he stated that the Muslims continued on that hill, and they lit fires around them. So basically, when they surrounded them, they lit fires around them, and then the thirst was obviously making it worse and difficult for them. So they gave themselves up as prisoners, okay, for fear of being slain. Their commanders, meaning they were taken as captive, okay, but the rest were killed, or taken prisoner. So then he mentions that basically they killed the rest of them, okay? وَقُتِلَ الْبَاقُونَ وَأَصَّرُوا. And they took prisoners. And amongst them, he mentions the list of those who handed themselves in and who were they, etc. وَأَمَّا الْبَاقُونَ مِنَ الْمُقَدِّمِينَ فَإِنَّهُمْ قُتِلُوا. He said, as for the sort of the rest of them, they were killed. And the other ones, okay, meaning the lower ones, they were basically divided either to be killed or to be taken as prisoners. Okay, so that's obviously from the Crusaders. That's sort of the battle. So obviously they defeated them. Now they've got the prisoners. Okay, the actual Knights Templars and the Crusaders themselves, meaning the soldiers and the commanders, they were executed as prisoners of war. Or they were taken as prisoners. Whereas the leaders, they were captured. So nothing happened to the leaders, okay? We'll now go into the story when the leaders or those of notability were presented to Salahuddin Ayubi. Okay, Qumus. Who's Qumus? Qumus is actually, if you watch the Kingdom of Heaven or Kingdom of Heaven, I'm sure probably some of you watched it. He was Reynold Châtillon. Reynold was the, I don't know whether you remember the movie, he was the kind of the one with the ginger hair. The one with the ginger hair, big mustache, and he was the one that, and I've probably watched the movie, I'm going to get to what happened to him. Then you got King Guy of Lusignan, okay? He was the actual leader who married the sister of the king of Jerusalem prior to him dying, the one who was suffering from leprosy. But that's, you know, talking about the sort of formation. It said the Sultan, meaning Salahuddin Ayubi, basically made a promise to kill this Reynold de Châtillon if he got him in his grasp, basically. And he goes, why is that? He goes, because there was a peace treaty, okay? And there was a caravan that was supposed to pass through his land. And this was a truce that they had. So what he did was, this individual basically killed those who were passing through his territory. So he mentioned, subhanAllah, he said, once the tent was basically set up, okay, وَنُصِبَتَ الْخَيْمَةِ, when the tent was set up, وَجَلَسَ فَرِحًا مَصْرُورًا شَاخِرًا, that Sultan Salahuddin Al-Ayubi rahmatullahi alayhi was sitting with great delight, okay, and being very grateful for the favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has showed him. Then what happened? This is where it gets interesting. What will transpire now is the scene from Kingdom of Heaven. So if you watch Kingdom of Heaven, this is the scene now that happened after the Battle of Hittin. Okay, so as you can see on screen, it says that he basically called this king, King Guy or Jafra, and his brother Reynold. Okay, he says that this king was given a drink. Okay, وَشَرِبَ مِنْهَا وَكَانَ عَلَى أَشَدِّ الْحَالِ مِنَ الْعَطَشِ, that basically the king drank and he was basically thirsty. Then he says he gave then some of it to drink to that Reynold. فَقَالَ لِسُلْطَانِ لِتَرْجَمَانِ, that when he gave the drink to the to his brother, the Sultan said to the interpreter, so Salahuddin Al-Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi said to the king, basically, I gave this drink to you and I haven't given him any drink. Basically, according to the custom of the Arabs and their akhlaq, that if a prisoner took food or drink, okay, from whoever had captured them, basically their life was spared. And Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi wanted to follow this particular way. Okay, he wanted to follow this particular way. So basically he set up basically a place for them to sort of reside, and he gave them something to eat and drink. He mentioned that he called them back again. Okay, so Sultan Salahuddin al-Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi basically summoned Reynold de Châtillon, okay, and said to him, look, embrace Islam. Okay, thumma arad alayhi al-Islam falam yaf'al, that he didn't embrace Islam. So basically what Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi did, he basically drew his sword and killed him. Okay, so when the king, so basically what happened was he struck him now. Okay, Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi struck that Reynold al-Châtillon, killed him. So the king, okay, must have seen this and thought, that's it, it's my turn next. Look at this. So Ibn Shaddad mentions that when the king saw this, he was basically, you know, when he envisioned that, that's it now, his turn's next. So Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi said this to him, subhanAllah, listen to these words. وَقَالَ لَمْ تَجْرِ عَادَةُ الْمُلُوكِ أَنْ يُقْتَلُوا الْمُلُوكِ وَأَمَّ هَذَا فَإِنَّهُ تَجَاوَزَ الْحَدْ فَجَرَ مَا جَرَ. He says, that is not the practice, okay, of the kings, to kill the kings. But this guy has transgressed his limits. So whatever happens, happened. He said, but in that night, they were basically grateful by sending praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thanking him and doing takbir and tahleel. Hatta tala' al-subh fi yawm al-ahad. And they did this until Sunday. Okay? So that was the Battle of Hittin. Okay? So the Battle of Hittin has now happened. Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi defeated the Crusaders in Hittin. Took back Tabriya and now defeated the majority of the Crusader army in Hittin. So that was the Battle of Hittin. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to present to you another account of another historian who was there with Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi at that time. So Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi was surrounded by many historians, and one of them historians was Ibn al-Athir, Sahib al-Kamil fi al-Tariq. And as you can see on screen, we got the book Al-Kamil fi al-Tariq, okay, by Ibn al-Athir. And I'm just going to summarize. It says that it's been narrated by Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi's son. He says, قال كنت إلى جانب الأبي. He said, I was with my father in the rows, okay, and I was witnessing what was happening on the hill, okay, with the franja, meaning the Crusaders. So the long story short is that he's seeing that the Muslims were going up the hill, coming down the hill, and they were trying to take, you know, the particular center of the battle. So the Muslims were getting pushed back. He was assuming that the Muslims were being victorious, but they were getting pushed back. So his father, Sultan Salahuddin Ayubi, said, "Uskut, be quiet. We haven't defeated them yet. Hatta tasqutu tilka al-khayma." Because we will not be victorious until we bring down this tent. And as soon as the tent then dropped, meaning that they defeated, they got up the hill and they dropped the tent, he says, "Fanazal al-Sultan." وَسَجَدَ شُكْرًا لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى. And he basically made sujood thanking Allah. And he said he cried due to happiness. So subhanAllah. So when his son was with him, he's saying, look, you know, we defeated them, but they were getting pushed back. And then when they got up the hill again, he shouted, we've defeated them. And they're getting pushed back. So Sultan Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullahi alayhi was getting fed up of this. And he goes, be quiet. We haven't defeated them until this tent drops. And as soon as he said it, the tent dropped. And Sultan Salahuddin Ayubi made sujood, shukran lillahi ta'ala, fabaka, and he cried due to happiness. Subhanallah. Now what's going to happen is that the pathway has been cleared, meaning the northern part of Palestine is under his control. He's defeated the major army of the Crusaders, he's captured their leaders, and he's obviously destroyed the majority of the Templars and the Crusaders. So, as those who know the map of Palestine, northern Palestine, like Haifa, Akka, Tibriya, Nazareth, and various areas of northern Palestine was now pretty much under his control. Tibriya, you're going to get to now, he takes Tibriya without a fight, but I'm just going to present that. So he's going to march down now, okay? So he's going to march down to Quds, and Quds is in like the West Bank, in Dafa Gharbiya, in the sort of central part of Palestine. He mentions that he took Tibriya, okay? Without any fight, okay, they surrendered, okay, and he took it without any confrontation, and this was on the Tuesday. Now, as you can see on screen, he mentions ذكر أخذ العكة, that they took عكة, okay. So I say he mentions ثم رحل قدس الله روحه طالبا عكة, that Sultan Salahuddin Ayubi basically departed for عكة وكان نزوله عليها يوم الأربعاء Salah Rabi' al-Akhir, that he basically arrived on the Wednesday, okay, arrived on the Wednesday, and he fought them, okay, he fought them, and he delivered, okay, the Muslim prisoners, and there were about 4,000 prisoners, subhanAllah al-Azim. So he took the money, the goods, and everything else. And then he mentions they took various coastal towns, wa akhadha Nablus, wa Haifa, wa Qasiriya, wa Sufriya, wa Nazareth. And basically, they were just capturing war booty, etc., etc. Then he says, and then he mentions the taking of this place called Timnin, okay? And he basically besieged it on a Sunday with obviously courageous men, strong in their religion. And basically, Salahuddin Ayubi, rahmatullah alayhi, Allah gave him victory by the Sunday. So he mentioned that this place at Timnin was basically besieged. The Muslims got victory. And then from there, he took prisoners. He went to a place called Saida, and he took that as well, okay? And then as you can see on screen, ذكر أخر البيروت, and now the taking of Beirut. So he mentions that Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi basically took the city on a Thursday. Basically, while he was attacking Beirut, many of his men took a place called Jubail, okay? and they were just carrying on. And then they mentioned, as you can see on screen, and then he mentioned Zakra Akhir al-Asqalan, that they took Asqalan. So Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alay basically took this area, and on the way there they took Ramla, Yubna, Darum, and basically the city fell to him on a Saturday, and he remained there while the other while his troops took over Gaza, Beit Jibrin, and Latrun without any fight. Okay, that's basically the end of this video. Okay, the next video, part three, the last part, where we're talking about the recapture of Baitul Maqdis, the capture of Jerusalem, and what happened when they took Jerusalem. Obviously, the siege before it, what happened when they took it, and how did Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi treat those crusaders in Baitul Maqdis. Now, bearing in mind, and obviously we haven't discussed it, when the crusade is the first crusade in 1099 after the Pope, I think it was Urban II, he called for the crusade, and he, the famous words, God willed it, God willed it. So when the crusaders finally entered Jerusalem, they slaughtered anyone they could find, even the Arab Christians, because they were just basically merciless. You know, everyone was a heretic, so they didn't differentiate. And they, it is said in the history books that blood was running knee high to the horses. Okay, that's how much slaughter took place in Jerusalem when they conquered the city. So you will see when Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi conquers Jerusalem, how he treated the people. And you'll get to that part as well. So this is part two. This shows that Salahuddin rahmatullah alayhi was a very patient man. You know, he endured so much, as you read in part one about the boils and, you know, about all the illnesses that he had whilst going out in campaigns. So you will see, bi'idhnillah, in part three, the conquest of Jerusalem and the recapture of the holy city, and thereafter the death of Salahuddin Ayubi rahmatullah alayhi. And we'll talk about what happened before his death as well, and how the people reacted when he passed away. So that's just, you know, a brief video. I know it's not really extensive. If I was to do this in one part, you know, meaning the his personal achievements, his character's nobility, the Battle of Hittin, the battles before it, and, you know, the battles after it, and then the subsequent recapture of Baitul Maqdis, and then his death, that would have been like an hour and a half video, and no one would watch a full hour and a half, so I decided to split it into parts. So alhamdulillah, another video done. Subhanallah al-Azim, I hope this video was beneficial. It wasn't as long as the first one. And the third one ain't going to be too long either. It's just going to get to the main parts. So, look after yourselves. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad. كم مرة عصف الأنين بداخلي كم مرة قد ضاق قلبي من أسى رحلتها وكم كرهت مصابها لكن رأيت الخير يسكب في أنا كم مرة قد ضقت من عظم البلاء بشر وشيطان يحاصرني أبا كم مرة قد أظلم الدرب ضحى وتحدر الدمع وضاقت بي رؤى كم مرة عصف الأنين بداخلي كم مرة قد ضاق قلبي من أسى رحلتها وكم كرهت مصابها لكن رأيت الخير يسكب في أنا كم مرة قد